It's a Friday morning. It's the 17th day in the month of July 2015. My name is Dapo Banjo. Welcome to Crossfire. This is Channel 196 on Star Times, and we are here to do, you know, our normal business. And I'm not alone. Ishama Againe is with me in the studio. Ishama, good morning. How are you doing?
I'm fine, thank you. Good morning. And good morning and welcome to Crossfire today. And happy Eid al-Fitr to all our Muslim brothers and sisters across the globe who are watching us.
All right. Good morning once again. We will be discussing some stories that are making headlines, and we definitely will be analyzing a couple of information that we have for you on the show. Yesterday, President Muhammad Buhari was practically begging Nigerians to be patient with him, and that he will definitely deliver on the change that he promised Nigeria before he was elected into office. We definitely will be talking today about, the administration of President Muhammadu Buhari and Buhari's cabinet delay. What danger exactly does it pose to Nigeria? And we have a gentleman in the studio who is joining us in really, really addressing this matter. It was one person that I learned recently sued the president to court, saying that your delay is denying Nigerians a lot of benefits and a lot of things that you have promised them, and that you have been working, that the president has been working in silos, and that this is very, very unconstitutional, and that it is very, very necessary for the president to come up with the ministerial list and let everybody hit the ground running, and so that we can begin to see the change that people voted for. Anyway, let's introduce our guest to you. He's a barrister, he's a lawyer, and he's good at what he does. I was trying to just read up his profile on LinkedIn, and I find out that this is someone who has been around and he knows his onions very well. Let's welcome barrister Ebun Olu Adeboluwa. You're welcome, sir, to Crossfire.
Welcome to Crossfire.
It's my pleasure. Good morning.
All right. Now, yesterday, the president, I really don't want to... It's one of the stories that are making headlines anyway. And the president, Muhammad Buhari, has begged Nigerians for patience and saying that he has been working meticulously to tackle the many national challenges which he identified. In his message to commemorate this year's Eid al-Fitr celebration, marking the end of Ramadan fast, President Muhammad Buhari stated that though there were heaps of misdeeds of the past administration, his government will ensure that every wrong of the past was corrected. He added that, you know, stamping out corruption still remains one of the cardinal objectives of his administration. According to him, there's much work to be done and every step will be corrected, will be correctly taken to ensure that there will be, it will not be business as usual. Now, before I come to you, I need to quickly let our viewers know exactly the angle that we definitely will be looking at, what we will be talking about today. It's been 50 days of President Muhammadu Buhari in office. And Nigerian Muhammadu Buhari took office about 50 days ago on a wave of change that he quickly will deal with deepening economic crisis and an Islamist insurgency in the north. Those were his plans. While Africa's biggest oil producer, Nigeria, has been hit by a 40% fall in petroleum prices in the past year and has slowed down economic growth and weakened the naira. As of today, the naira is about 250 naira to a dollar. Considering the momentum of his being the first opposition candidate to win power, during the elections, we expect that, something will happen almost immediately he assumes office. And like I said earlier on, it's been 50 days. What's your assessment? Do you think, PMB is calculatedly, working to ensure that the change that was promised to Nigerians is done, or is just docile?
First of all, is to correct the impression about the status of the president. He's a major general. He was commissioned in Nigerian Army. He took over power by force on December 31, 1983, and he's still collecting pension from the Nigerian Army. He cannot just wake up one day and decide to drop his title.
Well, he said it's a combated...
I'm saying that by law, I'm talking about law, Section 25 of the Armed Forces Act stipulates that anybody who is a commissioned officer of the Nigerian Army will continue to enjoy the status of membership of that noble profession. So,
but you know also that the Constitution of Nigeria is supreme. Now, irrespective of the fact that he was a commissioned military officer, he has now taken the oath of office to become the president of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. Are you saying that that oath and the title of the presidency is less and inferior to that of his major general, you know, his military titleship?
The oath of office has nothing to do with the status of the person taking the oath. Mm. It doesn't take away from your title. The good luck Jonathan took oath, he still remains a doctor. Shagari took oath, he still remains an alaji. Yaradua took oath, he's an alaji. I'm talking about the status, the title. What is prompting him to run away from the fact that he's a dictator? Is it a thing of shame to be a major general? That's only in this part of this country. In other climes, the military profession is a noble profession who chart the path of protecting their people. It's a noble thing. It's only here where you go to Bear Palace and take pepper soup and later you come and stage a coup and then discover that it was wrong to be taking over power by force. And when you are now correctly elected democratically, you want to run away from your past.
No. So it's becoming a thing of shame. I know fully well that if he still retained his military titleship, a lot of Nigerians, and I'm very sure your humble self, will have risen up to the occasion to speak against it, that he is still ridding Nigerians of the benefits of democracy. Why is he referring to himself as a military head of state, that now this is democracy, is as good as all things being done away with, and let him focus and take such title off the present administration? I mean, I think that's what we'll have been talking about now. So I don't think that, I mean, should that be a major issue?
For me, I think it makes a lot of sense. I think what Barista is saying, it makes a lot of sense to me. A general will always be a general.
I know,
it will
but not this nullify is democracy.
The fact. Yeah, it doesn't matter.
And
does
he
change the fact? Does
he
change his identity completely away that he was in
be,
the
he
military?
Should be identified as the president of the Federal Republic
Nobody
of Nigeria.
Is there anybody saying that he is
you
not?
You're adding major general, president. How does that sound?
No, we're not saying that. Nobody has said that. No, nobody said that.
Let's get the issue straight. It's not about referring or addressing. I cannot ever remove from the fact that I was called to the Nigerian bar in 1995. Mm-hmm. No matter, even if I become president today, I can't take away that status. I'm talking about his profession. Mm-hmm. Somebody left secondary school.
But it's a personal
not,
thing.
It's a personal thing on how he wants to be addressed.
But as regards how he wants to be addressed,
anyway,
he hasn't said he's no longer a military general.
Let's discuss more.
In any case, no matter the designation that you ask people to address you, your actions will speak for that status. Everything this man has done since May 29 has qualified him to be a major general. He's a dictator. Making appointments, the chairman of INEC says, I'm leaving office. I recommend that this person be handled. The following day, it drove him away. And since he got into office, there's no minister, there's no secretary, there's no chief of staff. It's just a one-man riot. So even if he asks you to call him president, by his action now, he's a major general.
Okay, let's say this. Let's put the show in perspective so that, we can make information available to Nigerians. What we are looking at is Buhari's cabinet delay. Is it a danger? Will this pose any danger to Nigeria as a country? What's your analysis? Let's listen to you. Let's know your perspective. I mean, knowing fully well that it was on this premise that you have sued the president to court. That is working in silos, and that is very, very not good for the change that that he promised Nigerians.
Now, we must situate this discussion in some perspective.
Okay.
Nigeria, from the Constitution, is called Federal Republic of Nigeria. And Sections 4, Section 5, Section 6 specify what that republic should be like. In Section 4, it says that there shall be a legislature responsible for making law. Section 5 says there shall be an executive responsible for implementing decisions. And then Section 6 says there should be a judiciary responsible for interpreting law and settling disputes between persons. The legislature was inaugurated on June 9, and immediately, that same day, they elected their officers, constituted their cabinet, and they are currently, as we speak, constituting their various committees, because the Senate president can't rule alone. In the same vein, it's expected that since May 29, when the president was elected, he will constitute a cabinet. Section 148, Section 147 is very clear. The word that is used in the Constitution is that the president shall It's an obligation. He has no choice about it. We did not anticipate that we will elect a person who will be a woman riot over 180 million people and be taking our destiny for granted and then be ruling us in confusion and throwing us into all manner of unpredictable circumstances. And you see, let me just give you an instance of the challenge in not constituting a cabinet. Currently, people have written WAEC, they have written JAM, they have written NECO, no cut-off mark. There's no minister in the Ministry of Education.
JAM actually constituted a body to determine what the cut-off mark was going to be.
If there is a minister of education, for instance, he will coordinate those people. If there's a minister, for instance, of power, he will coordinate the things happening in the power sector. If there's a minister for petroleum, for instance, by now we're talking about whether we want to pass the old PMB or we want to do a new one. But a person, just a single person, sitting down to be minister of petroleum, minister of education, is attorney general of himself.
But you know also that the Constitution does not provide a time limit for such appointment. Now, if the person has not said, I would not nominate or present ministers. He has said he will. But now, if the Constitution provided for a time limit, saying probably a month, when you were sworn in or this and that and that, it should have been easier. Don't you think it should have been easier to hold the president accountable for defiling the provisions of the Constitution? But when the Constitution does not make any time limit, how can you hold him to ransom after the president hasn't said he would not appoint ministers? So on what ground are you bringing this?
Okay.
What sufficient ground are you bringing your actions?
Thank you. Like I said, when I started, I said the Constitution clearly says he shall appoint persons to occupy offices. Now talking about time, sections 148, 147 says clearly that the president shall hold regular meetings. I want you to note the word shall and regular. The president shall hold regular meetings with the vice president and ministers of the Federal Republic. Regular. Now, the word regular means
define
constant.
Regular.
No, I don't want to.
It could be every month.
I'm not here
it
for
could
laughing.
Be six
I'm
months.
A, this is a serious matter because I'm in court. The word regular means constant, frequent, weekly. During the Jonathan's period, the Federal Executive Council meets every Wednesday. It's weekly. We're not here for joke, man. Regular means that constantly, every time. Because issues arising in Nigeria needs to be discussed. Policies have to be formulated.
Tenders down, maybe on a daily basis.
I'd like you to put it in context. For projects to be considered, you have to make tenders. It has to be brought to the Executive Council. There has to be debate. There have to be award of contracts. So when you talk about regular, it's anticipating that every week, every constant period, there will be memos flying from the various ministries, from the ministers, presentations, president will be meeting with them, discussing how to implement policies. And we're talking about May 29, man. And the reason why I said there is a time limit on it is that I believe that the word regular means frequent, constant, often. And we have not had any meeting since May 29.
Because there's nobody to
meet. And today we are in July, man. And we're almost coming to the end of July.
The word regular could mean 6 months.
Regular? 6 months.
Yes. But the truth is, as long as the Constitution, in my own opinion though, and I'm very sure many other lawyers and many other Nigerians share that opinion also, as long as there's no definite time limit provided by the Constitution, then I don't know how sufficient you can hold Mr. President to ransom that he must appoint such ministers.
So your word regular could be September, it could
be
next year.
The issue about regular is not in contention. The issue
you
is
said it could be 6 months.
Time limit. No, the time limit was not given by our Constitution.
Okay, look, the point we'll make is this. If, for instance, I'm appointed as the President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, Section 151 says there shall be an attorney general who shall be the chief law officer of the federation, who shall not be less than 10 years post-call, and will be appointed, will be the chief law officer, the advisor. Honestly, let's take the case of the president and look at the point for where we're coming. This is somebody who has no other education other than military training. How does he interpret laws? How does he direct his policies in relation to legal matters? How does he get advice in respect of this?
We don't have a chief justice of the federation. We don't have a constituted. It's not that we are separately constituting a court that will, or a body, or another institution aside from the judiciary that we interpret law and ensure that people get justice or judgment, as the case may be. So, I mean, how has the president, I mean, so far fared not having a cabinet to work with, especially, you know, when we talk about the major ministries, even though we have heard that the people who sit on the ministries today, that the ministries is not that they are idle, they've been working because the, you know, the DGs of the various ministries have been working. So I want to really know the danger that the delay in naming his cabinet is actually constituting or causing Nigerians.
Let me give you an instance.
Okay.
Upon being sworn, the president had a desire to do away with all members of the Directorate of State Security, DSS, from taking over security in Aso Rock. And so he was misadvised. A memo was written from his CSO asking all DSS officers to vacate the villa. Mm-hmm. It took 3 days for them to come up to say, look, go and check the law setting up DSS. That law states specifically that we are the one responsible for providing close monitoring for
security,
the president.
Yes.
It was an embarrassment to the president because he had no advisor, because he had no attorney general. He had no lawyer who could initiate those advice and tell him, no, you don't get out this memo.
This way.
You can take out the individuals, but you need to replace them because they must be there. That's what the law says. And had that had to be reversed, which led to the posting of people out and changing
and
them. But you couldn't do away with DSS from staying in the villa because that's what the law created them to do. But because the president was not aware, and I don't blame him. Look, honestly, I commend the president to say he brought himself to handle the problems of Nigeria. But the areas where you are not trained, allow others. Team means together, everybody will work together. There's no way a single person can run a country of 180 million people and still be in office by July, and he's not considered a cabinet, and he's not even doing anything about it at all. It can work. To say that we will not get into office by September, no minister. And let me take another example, stock exchange. Stock exchange has to do with financial market, how people bring investments into Nigeria, how people come to invest in the economic fortunes of this country. Look at the stock exchange, what people are losing every day. Because of the unpredictable nature of the economy, there's no minister in charge. There's nobody giving us a policy direction of where the government's action is going to be like. And so on the floor of the stock exchange, every day the thing is plummeting and falling because there's nobody in charge.
All right.
Look at the dollar.
All right.
For instance, no minister of economic affairs.
We'll come back to that. All right. Let's quickly go on a short break. When we come back, we'll still have Ebunlu Adegorua in the studio. And we're still talking about Buhari's cabinet delay. Is it posing any danger to Nigerians or to Nigeria as a country? We'll be right back.
So, did you like what you just saw? I know you did. Mm-hmm. It's very simple. If you want to see more, just subscribe to our channel right now.